Thank you, everyone, for joining us for Grand Rounds today. We are so excited to have Dr. Elizabeth Viglianti presenting. Dr. Viglianti is an assistant professor in the Department of Internal Medicine in the Division of Pulmonary and Critical Care at the University of Michigan. She's also a member of the Institute of Healthcare Policy and Innovation. Dr. Viglianti's research focuses on improving healthcare of vulnerable populations, either from physiologic derangements or from social reasons. Her social justice work focuses on the experience of and the organizational response to, or not, patient-perpetrated sexual harassment. Dr. Viglianti earned her BA from the University of California, Berkeley, and her medical degree from the Duke University School of Medicine. She received her master's in public health from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill and a master's of science from the University of Michigan. She completed her internal medicine residency and pulmonary and critical care fellowship at the University of Michigan. We're so fortunate to have Dr. Viglianti presenting today. You may have also seen her at the end of July when she was a panelist on our session on improving gender equity in pulmonary and critical care medicine. Dr. Viglianti's talk today is entitled Hashtag Her Time Is Now, Gender Discrimination and Sexual Harassment in Academic Medicine. As usual, please put your questions in the chat. Dr. Viglianti, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Dr. Althoff and Dr. Sorgue, for the kind invitation to come and speak to all of you again. So honestly, these conversations are just tough, and I'm happy to continue to build off the prior conversations we had not long ago and hopefully spark new ones. So before I go any further, I'd like to acknowledge the following individuals who have all played big roles in the research I'm going to present and who have continued to encourage me to do the research that I'm doing. Like many, I come into research with two hats. I come in with a critical care hat because of the patients I take care of in the ICU. But for many of us, there's also other reasons why we do research, and some of it's from personal experiences or wanting to make a difference in other lives. And my work going into patient-perpetrated sexual harassment stems directly from that. So when I was a third-year fellow in pulmonary clinic at Michigan Medicine, I had a patient encounter unlike any other. There was a gentleman who was looking to establish care, and he was brand new to the system. He just moved in from out of state, so there wasn't really much in terms of the medical record. All I knew was that he had advanced COPD and needed to establish care. And when I opened that door to meet him, he looked me up and down, and he said, "Must be my lucky day to meet such a sexy, attractive doctor." And at the time, I did what many of us do. I laughed it off, giggled nervously, and just wanted to get on with the encounter. I knew I had 30 minutes to figure out what exactly I needed to find out from him to help him improve in his breathing, or at least figure out how to help him. But the encounter continued with comments of, "If I were your husband, the things I could do to you," or, "You're too young and pretty to be a doctor." And when I tried to get an understanding of how far could he walk before he became short of breath, it was, "If you were standing at the end of a treadmill, it would be motivation enough to chase you." And so I stayed in that encounter the entire 30 minutes until I had gotten enough information to present it to my attending and figure out the plan. But I left that encounter really, really upset. And oftentimes when I've shared this story, people are like, "You should have just left. Like, why'd you even bother staying?" But the reality was, I was never safe and I never felt safe. So this patient went from laughing and giggling to crying to being anger all within seconds of each other. So I didn't quite know how to handle that. And as some of you who I know, when I get upset or things happen to me, I tend to talk to people. And I certainly was talking about this experience, and only to realize it was not a isolated experience, but in fact, many female trainees, attendings, medical students have experienced similarly. And so off I went to try to understand what we could do to begin to address patient-perpetrated harassment. So the big takeaways from this talk are the following. The National Academies of Science, Engineering, and Medicine, otherwise known as NASEM, provides a framework of how to think about sexual harassment. Sexual harassment is common, and the most vulnerable amongst us experience it at higher rates. Gender disparities exist in many aspects of academic medicine, and it's driven by systemic barriers which can be addressed. Gender equity is an ethical imperative, and the organizational response is critical. So a bit of an outline of what we're going to talk about. We are going to talk about the landscape currently in academic medicine. We'll talk about gender disparities in academic medicine in kind of a 20,000 foot view from articles that have been published. I'll then transition into sexual harassment in academic medicine, and we're going to end with patient-perpetrated sexual harassment at the end. So let's talk a little bit about what the landscape is in academic medicine. So what seems like eons ago, but really wasn't that long ago, was the famous Me Too movement that initially began in Hollywood and really put a focused lens on sexual harassment there. But that lens soon shifted over to academic medicine. And in medicine, there had been a lot of attention focused on trying to increase the number of women applying to medical school and therefore the higher ranks in medicine. But yet they were leaving, and this leaky pipeline had been created. So in 2018, the National Academies of Science, Engineering, and Medicine released a report focusing on sexual harassment, because that was thought to be one of the many factors contributing to women leaving academic medicine. It's a report that I recommend we all read, because the findings are still valuable even today. And that report was really an awakening to not women per se, but more to men and those in power and overall the greater public community about what was happening in academic medicine. From that report came this famous iceberg that's received significant attention, but I think is still worth pondering. So when people think of sexual harassment, they normally think of what's at the tip of the iceberg, which is normally sexual coercion and unwanted sexual attention, which, don't get me wrong, those are horrible, right? No one wants to experience those things. And that's generally what we think of when someone talks about sexual harassment. This purple line here is the public consciousness, which, like an iceberg, there is plenty below the surface. And the most common form of sexual harassment is actually gender harassment, which lies underneath the public consciousness. And gender harassment was defined by the NASA report as a broad range of verbal and nonverbal behaviors not aimed at sexual cooperation, but that they convey insulting, hostile, and degrading attitudes about members of one's gender. So how does academic medicine compare to other sectors in American society? Well, we're at the top, which is not the place where we want to be. We're not number one, though. But the academic workplace has the second highest rate of sexual harassment as compared to the military, private, and governmental sectors. The only sector that's actually worse than us is the military. So we are number two in a place where we don't want to be in the top. And when we think about how do our trainees do with regards to sexual harassment, these bars, these dark bar here is gender harassment, this lighter bar here is crude behavior, and then you have unwanted sexual attention and sexual coercion. On this far right side is medicine, as compared to the other sciences and as compared to the non-sciences. And so we are leading the pack even here. So one may ask, what are the greatest predictors of sexual harassment? And so certainly individuals can have factors, right? People can have sexist ideas, beliefs, and they can justify them, which then leads to behavior that's inappropriate. But if you place these individuals in an environment where harassment is not tolerated, they're not likely to exhibit such behaviors. Fantastic. So then what are the organizational factors that we can do or like that lead or associated with sexual harassment? And there's four that were highlighted by the NASA report. The first and second are male dominated and isolation and training. The next is hierarchical dependence. And then the last one is organizational tolerance. Now, I don't think it comes as any big surprise that when you think of all four categories, this is medicine unto itself. We are a predominantly male-dominated field where there is quite a bit of isolation and training between trainees and attendings. We are a pyramid, for better or worse, and organizational tolerance is really, really dependent on the institutions and the environments. So one is not surprised then that medicine has such an issue with sexual harassment. Fortunately, the report does give us ways of addressing these. So for male dominated, it comes down to diversity. It's diversity in hiring, it's hiring and retaining more women, it's implicit bias training, and it's broader networks for recruitment. We often tend to recruit people that we know, and one can imagine how biased that may actually be. Isolation and training. I think for me, when I think about pulmonary critical care and specifically, like, yes, I was a fellow and I had an attending in the ICU, but where you really get into the dyads when we start talking more about research. And so having mentoring committees and networks, so you're not dependent on one person if that relationship does not work out. Having divisional funds, again, for that same purpose, you're not dependent on one person. And having division sponsorship coordination. So again, you're breaking down that dyad in case that dyad does not work out for the individuals. Hierarchical dependence, that comes to diffusing power structures and isolation and changing from an authoritarian leadership to more of an egalitarian leadership style. And lastly, when we talk about organizational change, that's transparency and accountability. Knowing if you file a report that something is actually happening and it's not just sitting in someone's email is really, really important. And I think it gets to a lot about the cultural change. And the other thing is having clear and easily disseminated harassment policies. It's really hard sometimes to find these policies, and having them easily accessible speaks, I think, to the organizational component of change. So more recently, there have been these public campaigns. This was the one from last year, which was the Her Time Is Now, received a lot of attention on media, on social media. And the Her Time Is Now campaign was actually a call to healthcare leaders. And it was intersecting on the relationship with the three big gatekeepers for career advancement in academic medicine: medical schools and hospitals, medical journals, and then medical societies when we start thinking about networking. And I think those are all really, really valuable. But I also think there's also another fundamental component, and that's money. Whether it's in salaries, funding, startup packages, I think you need all of these in order to help women be successful in academic medicine. To do service, there is another campaign that was started this summer, and it was Give Her a Reason to Stay in Healthcare. It should come as no big surprise. COVID has been with us now 18 months, and I think we in Michigan are preparing for our fourth wave as we speak. And there has certainly been a hard impact on women, as well as others, as we try to stay in academic medicine. And what we know is that women, as compared to men, were the majority of the frontline workers during the pandemic. Women are already disadvantaged when it comes to promotions before the pandemic. It's only going to get worse, I suspect, as we go through and survive this pandemic. Women are also often looked as the good citizens, meaning that they are often, and I love this phrase, voluntold to engage in underpaid work that others don't want to do. And then there's the juggling of multiple hats that one may be wearing. I myself am dealing with two kids, an academic career and clinical responsibilities, and just feel like I'm constantly going. And so all these reasons are leading to women being burned out and wanting to leave the academic world. Right, so I'm going to give you a 20,000 foot view of gender disparities in academic medicine. These are not all the published studies. There are way too many to go over. But we're going to talk about the four in terms of the four gatekeepers of academic medicine. And the first one we're going to focus on is money. And it's going to come in two flavors. The first, it's going to be in salaries. And the second one, it's going to be in terms of grant funding and funding her. So one of the studies that I think quite a bit about is a study that was published by Dr. Jagsey here from the University of Michigan back in 2012. And what I love about this study is that it looked at gender differences in salaries. Historically, what many people had said is that, well, you know, men get paid more money than women because of the careers they choose, and they work more, and they're just so much more productive than women, and therefore they deserve more money. And certainly that may be true. But in her analysis, it really brings that to question. So this study was done in a homogeneous group of early career investigators that were all NIHK funded investigators between 2000 and 2003. So these were people that all really wanted to stay in academic medicine. And what she found in her elegant analysis, because you can see everything that she controlled for in her analysis, is that men early in their careers still made more money than women. And that difference was about $12,000. Now, some may say $12,000, that's not a lot of money. I would never say that. $12,000, I think, is a lot of money. But if you think of $12,000 over a 30-year career, and that's assuming there's no increase in this gap, that's a difference of $360,000 over a woman's academic career. And that, I think, is a fair amount of money that we are just being shortchanged. And so one may ask and think, well, maybe it's just when you're early career, but if you make it and become a department chair, maybe it gets better. And so this was a study that was published by Dr. Menashe in JAMA Internal Medicine in 2020. And this specifically looked at department chairs across 29 US public schools. And again, you can see what they adjusted for in their model. But amongst men and female department chairs, there was a salary difference of $67,000, which again is fairly significant when we think about salary differences as we move up the ranks in academic medicine. Okay, so we don't make enough in salary, but maybe our odds are better when we think about research. So this was a study that I just think is really, really intriguing. It was published by Dr. Segg, I'm probably mispronouncing the word name, in JAMA in 2015. And this was simply looking at startup packages. As an early career researcher, I have come to appreciate startup packages are actually really important because the NIH grants, especially the case, don't cover everything that you need. And it may even be more important for those that are doing basic science. So in this study, they looked at two New England biomedical research programs, and they just simply looked at startup packages. The median startup package for men was $889,000. And you can see what the spread is, as compared to the median startup package for women, which is about $350,000. And you can see what the spread is there. So at the beginning of one's career, when one is really looking to begin to hire and do the work that you said you were going to do to lead, to become an independent investigator, men are having more money put into their pockets to be able to do that than women are. And the statistical significance in the study actually came amongst the PhDs. So those that are doing basic science, where startup packages probably mean even more. And so women are starting at a disadvantage from the get-go, from salaries as well as startup packages. How do we do with grants and with funding mechanisms? So honestly, this is one of my favorite studies. It was done by Dr. Whitman, published in The Lancet in 2019. And this was really trying to understand if funding was related to the science or the scientists. Did it matter? And it does. So I don't quite know what was happening in Canada, but this study took advantage of a natural experiment that was occurring in Canada. And between 2011 and 2014, Canada had a traditional grant program mechanism. But in 2014, they decided to split that traditional grant program into two programs. They had the project grant program and they had the foundation grant program. The project grant program was really focused on looking at the science. So it was scored heavily on the science, 75% of it, and 25% of it was scored on the applicant. The foundation grant program was the exact opposite. So it was scored heavily on the applicant, and then they looked at the science. When they looked at the trend of success, so in the traditional mechanism, men did get more grants than women, but it wasn't by much. When they broke it down after 2014 in the project grant, it looks really similar in terms of the success rate as compared to the traditional program. But there was quite a bit of difference noticed in the foundation program, where men were just more successful than women. They took a bit of a deeper dive into the foundation grant program to try to understand when that gender discrepancy occurred. And so what we found and what they reported is that the foundation grant program was actually done in two phases. In phase one is where they really did value and look at the applicant. And this dark green bar are men. So men were favored quite a bit more than women during that initial screening phase. But then when you actually got to the science and evaluating the science, women did just as well, if not better, at that stage. And the authors offered three possible reasons. The first was perhaps there's individual bias at the reviewer. can't do anything about it. They're just biased. They don't like women scientists. Okay, fine, not great, but okay. The second is perhaps their systemic bias. And what they argued is that this is the cumulative advantage of men. They're more likely to receive higher salaries. They're more likely to receive higher startup packages. I haven't shown you this yet, but I'll show you about publications and that men are more likely to get higher impact publications and they're more readily accepted. So ultimately, this is all leading to men having better CVs as compared to their female colleagues. The other possible hypothesis was that women were less likely to put themselves up for these foundation awards, and they're less likely to pursue leadership roles because perhaps they're so busy promoting their mentees that it's taking an expense of their careers. And then the last thing that they had noted is that women in general tend to use more modest language as compared to their male colleagues. And so maybe in combination of all of these things, women are actually being undervalued in these foundation grants. It's something that's at least thought-provoking to think about. So I had alluded to this, but we're going to talk specifically about what we know about journals and journal publications, since the common phrase that I've always been told is publish or perish. And so this was another study that I think offers a really unique perspective when we start thinking about publications. This was a study, again, done by Dr. Jagzi, published in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2006. And it looks at the gender gap in authorship over a 35-year perspective. It looked at authorship of the first and senior author and categorized them as either male or female. And they all were restricted to US authors. And the journals that they decided to look at were all high impact journals. I think all of us would agree, it'd be great to get a publication in the New England Journal of Medicine or JAMA. And so these were journals that we would all want to publish in. That 35-year time span was from 1970 to 2004. And so here you have in the blue bars are first authors and the red bars are senior authors and the percent females on your y-axis. And so certainly from 1970 to 2004, there was an increased representation of female first and senior authors. I will highlight that even in 2004, less than 30% of first authors were female and senior authors were less than 20% in these journals. Now, some may argue, well, there weren't that many women that were entering academic medicine at this time, so certainly you couldn't expect them all to be publishing in these premier journals, which maybe there's truth to that, maybe there's not. But when we think about these premier journals, I think the other thing we think about are the guest editorials that often accompany the articles. And so here, what I'm showing you is the New England Journal of Medicine is in blue and JAMA is in red. The percent of female representation in the guest editorials are on the y-axis. As we move from 1970 to 2004, again, there is increased representation of females being present in these guest editorials, but it's really not by much. In 2004, in New England Journal of Medicine, it was slightly greater than 10%. And in JAMA, it was slightly under 20%. And that's 2004. And I bring this up because guest editorials, as far as I know, people are invited to do them at the discretion of the editors. So this begins to speak to the networking and the sponsorship of women. So perhaps women weren't submitting articles to these journals, but it'd be surprising if the editors didn't know women that could perhaps write the guest editorials, which would certainly help one's career, even if they're not original research publications. I think we can't talk about publications without really talking about COVID-19 and the impact that that's had on women. And certainly that's received significant attention in that there are fewer first and senior female author publications during COVID and specifically on COVID-19 research. You can see here in the study that was done by Dr. Anderson, first authorships in 2019 as compared to 2020 with COVID-19 papers, women, proportion of women is down. Similarly with last authorship and then similarly in the full group. One may say, well, maybe it's just unique to medicine and COVID-19 research. The reality is that these findings have been validated in other areas of medicine, including surgery, published in JAMA Surgery. And so I think this is a true phenomena, the repercussions of which we have yet to see as women start to go up for promotion and as they try to write their next grants, because publications matter. We're going to talk about sponsorship, and I alluded to this slightly when we talked about the guest editorials and how important it is in regards to building these networks. But before I move further, just to make sure that we're all on the same page. So this has been repeated over and over again. I think it bears repeating again. Mentors, they're super important. They come from any level of the hierarchy and often work hand in hand to offer guidance and support. Sponsors are highly placed individuals who have the power and influence to advocate for that person. So sponsorship is riskier than mentorship because sponsors tend to spend their quote unquote chips that they've accrued during their profession to advocate for someone in whom they see nascent ability or the potential. And so sponsorship's really a different breed altogether. In the business world, men benefit from sponsorship more than women. And they think that actually is leading to the gender gap in leadership. And the question is that true in medicine as well? So let's see what we know here. Dr. Patton had published the study in JAMA Internal Medicine back in 2017. And again, it was looking at differences in mentor-mentee sponsorship in this select cohort of K awardees from 2006 to 2009. Who remained in academics in 2014. And they really wanted to assess sponsorship experiences and the impact of sponsorship on academic success. They defined academic success. So they said you would be considered successful if you had an R01 grant or grant funding that was over $1 million. You published more than 35 peer-reviewed publications, or you served as dean chair or division chief. Sponsorship was also defined. They asked if they had been invited to serve as an oral discussant at a national meeting. Were you invited to write an editorial, invited to join an editorial review board, or invited to serve on a national committee? Here's what they found. So this dark blue bar is going to be men with male mentors, and then it goes men with female mentors, women with male mentors, and the lightest colored bar is women with female mentors. This composite score is if the mentee said yes to any of these four. And so by and large, what you are seeing is this dark blue bar is always higher than the light blue bar. So men with male mentors are reporting more sponsorship from their mentors as compared to female mentors across all four categories. What this implies is that gender concordance does not solve sponsorship differences, meaning we will still need men to become allies and lean in to help promote women in academic medicine. Female mentees will need the men. It's just the reality of where we are in academics right now. And so I think several hypotheses came from why this may be. Why are females mentees not doing as well, and what can explain these sex differences? And so the possible thoughts here: female mentees may have less powerful mentors who therefore can't act as sponsors. Perhaps female mentees are asking for different type of mentorship, one that focuses more on work-life balance and less on like national promotion, or they may be thought as being asking for that type of mentorship. The other thing may be that mentors may not be thinking of their female mentees, and in fact, they think more of their male mentees when sponsorship opportunities come. I think there are things to think about, especially when we start thinking about implicit bias and how that may influence sponsorship at the very least. So let's talk a little bit about promotions. We've alluded to this throughout the talk thus far, and it's no big stranger to us that women constitute only about 24% of division chiefs, 24% of vice chairs, 15% of department chairs, and 16% of school deans, or somewhere around there. We are nowhere near the majority. But there's different ways of thinking about this, and certainly a lot of attention has been paid to this, so maybe we've made headway. And the answer is not really. So women in this study done by Dr. Rector that was published in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2020, women accounted for about 38.9% of the graduates during this study period. And 40.8% of the graduates that were females ended up going to become assistant professors. So the data suggests that women are slightly more likely to choose an academic career in medicine as compared to their male colleagues. But when we look at time to promotion, so the first graph is time to promotion from assistant professor to associate professor. On the x-axis, you have time. On the y-axis, you have the cumulative probability of promotion. Men get there faster than women do. Similarly, when you look at associate professor to full professor, again, this blue line is men. They get there faster than women do. And if you're an underrepresented minority in medicine and a woman, you are twice as slow to get to these next promotions. So the authors go on to say that women assistant professors are less likely than their male colleagues to be promoted to associate professor. You can see the hazard ratio. Full professor, you can see the hazard ratio, and then department chairs. So you're not likely to see yourself if you're a medical school trainee and a female in the upper echelons of the hierarchy. One can consider different solutions of how do we fix this? And this was a really intriguing editorial that was published that perhaps one way of considering fixing this is unclogging the pipeline. And it was a call for term limits in academic medicine. So apparently there's about 2,100 permanent clinical department chairs serving US medical schools. With the average term length for men being about 8.7 years, for women it's about 6.1. And when you look at people that have remained for a minimum of 12 years, only 7% of those are women. And so men are really staying in these leadership positions for prolonged periods of time, which makes it hard for women to kind of navigate their way up if there's no openings up top. This graph here is showing what would happen if we do nothing to change term in regards to term limits. So we have reached gender equity in most medical schools now. In fact, one year we had 70% female medical students here at Michigan Medicine. And if we do absolutely nothing, we reach gender equity in 2070, which is a really, really, really long time. And some leaders I know have been in office for at least 30 to 43 years, which is in a person's entire academic career if they decide to stay at the same academic center for a prolonged period of time. And so some things may need to start to change. So a quick synopsis of what I just showed you is that in summary, in academic medicine, women are paid less than men for the same academic achievements, whether you're starting early in your career or you're a department chair. They receive less research funding when the focus is on the applicant, but not on the science. They're underrepresented in the premier journals and in editorials, even when it's at the discretion of the editors. They receive less sponsorship, and gender concordance is not going to be sufficient. We will need men to be allies and lean in to help promote women. And women in general just hold fewer leadership positions, and perhaps we need to unclog the pipeline by putting in term limits. So let's shift to something a little harder to talk about. We're going to move to sexual harassment. And so what do we know about sexual harassment in academic medicine? This was a study done by Dr. Jagzi, again, published in JAMA Internal Medicine in 2016. And it looked to see what were the experiences of faculty with regards to sexual harassment, which was defined here. So sexual harassment was generalized sexist remarks and behavior, inappropriate sexual advances, subtle bribery, to engage in sexual behavior, threats to engage in sexual behavior, and then coercive advances, all the yucky stuff. So what did they find? The blue bar is going to be female, the red bar is going to be male, and the percent that responded yes is going to be on your y-axis. So women certainly perceive more gender bias, they experience more gender bias, and they experience more sexual harassment as compared to their male colleagues. Of those that reported sexual harassment, they went ahead and asked them further questions about what kind of sexual harassment did they receive. And so I will bring attention that among the women who reported sexual harassment, more than 40% of them reported the most severe forms of sexual harassment. That's a lot of sexual harassment and not the kind that anyone wants to experience ever. needless to say, there's still over 90% of them that also reported that they were experiencing sexist remarks or behaviors. So this is just a huge problem all the way through and through. And the implications of this is that we really need to work on recognizing sexual harassment is important, because the perception that such experiences are rare or the one-offs ironically increases the stigmatization and discourages reporting. So efforts to mitigate the effect of unconscious bias in the workplace and eliminate more overtly inappropriate behaviors are really, really needed. The more we talk about it, I think the more likely we are to advance our conversations. So this was among academic faculty, but how are we doing with our trainees and how are their experiences? This was a study that was published by Dr. Hugh in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2019. And it's such an important study because for the longest time, we didn't quite know what was happening within a national representative cohort of trainees. Many studies had been done in single centers, so you didn't quite know. You knew it was a problem, but you just didn't know how bad of a problem it was. So this was a cross-sectional national survey of general surgery residents that was administered in 2018 during their in-training examination. And they asked them about different forms of discrimination and abuse and harassment. And what they found was that 30% of them reported gender discrimination, 30% of them reported verbal or physical abuse, another 16% reported racial discrimination, and 10% reported sexual harassment. They then broke this down also by gender. And so the gold yellow color is going to be female and the blue is going to be male and the gray is just the overall group. And percent that said yes is going to be on your y-axis. And so for gender discrimination, racial discrimination, and sexual harassment, more females reported experiencing all of these as compared to their male colleagues. They went a step further and asked these trainees, well, who were the perpetrators of these harassments? And so what you have here are the sources of the discrimination and harassment. We're going to have three categories of gender discrimination, racial discrimination, and sexual harassment. Overall report is on the far left, and then it goes men, and then it goes female. What I want to draw your attention to is this dark blue bar that's the most biggest source for gender discrimination, racial discrimination, and sexual harassment. Our patients and patients' families for our female trainees. Certainly attendings give the families a run for their money when we talk about sexual harassment, but this is one of the first few times that we've actually been able to capture how problematic patients and their families can be for our trainees when it comes to harassment and discrimination. So let's talk a little bit about patient-perpetrated sexual harassment. As I shared with all of you earlier, this was an area that I came into because of my own experience and trying to figure out what was out there, what guidance could I find for me, for my colleagues, as we all commiserated. And the reality is that there are a lot of gaps in terms of what we know about patient-perpetrated harassment. And so I've taken the approach of trying to look at policies, because I think policies speak quite a bit of what we can turn to when we run into situations. And specifically, I've come at it from two different directions. The first is, what do healthcare systems tell their trainees about patient-perpetrated harassment and how do they prepare them? And the second is, what do healthcare systems tell their patients and their families about expected behaviors towards the healthcare professionals that they are seeing? So the first study that I did was published back in 2019 in the Journal of General Internal Medicine, and it specifically was surveying DIOs, or designated institutional officers. DIOs are the middle people between a residency fellowship program and the accrediting body. And so theoretically, they have the insights to know what policies are actually being implemented for the trainees all within that academic center. And we wanted to ask them. It was supposed to be a simple study. It of course, was not. Can you share with us your sexual harassment policies, the training that you have for the broad category? And then can you more specifically tell us if you talk about patient-perpetrated harassment and if you have policies, training, and protocols? Of the top 20, so we surveyed the top 20 U.S. hospitals and sent their DIO surveys, 11 of them responded. and agreed to share their policies. And what we have from the 11 that responded is certainly they all have a sexual harassment policy, as would be expected. But slightly more than 50% of them actually have a training that specifically talks about sexual harassment. When we start to look at patient perpetrated harassment policies, trainings, that drops to less than 50%. In fact, the majority of these programs do not have policies or trainings that speak to patient perpetrated harassment. And when we talk about protocols, like what do you do with these patients once this behavior occurs, you get closer to 50% slightly. If you think about that, they think that they know, that they tell their trainees what to do when these encounters occur. Since only 11% responded, we went ahead and looked for publicly available policies for the other institutions. Now, two institutions shared policies, so really the denominator is 19. One policy was completely behind a firewall that we just couldn't get access to. So of the 18 that we had, all of them had a sexual harassment policy. Again, when we looked to see if patient perpetrated sexual harassment, if we could identify it, and it clearly stated patients, that number rises to slightly above 25%. We gave leeway if it was implied. If they had mentioned in their policies third-party visitors, then we said, sure, I guess a patient and their family could fall into that category. And if we do that, then we can go over the 50% line. But again, when we look for protocols of like, what do you do with these patients? It falls below 25%. And honestly, you're really talking about one institution who clearly stated in their policies what patient perpetrated harassment was, what was covered by the policy, what to do when a patient harassed you, and what number to call and who to speak to. It was a really clean algorithm, but that was one institution. So there is much work to be done. We don't really prepare our trainees for these encounters, and we don't have the policies there to help support them when they go looking for them. Perhaps we do a better job from the other side. And one can look at what we tell patients and their families by looking at the Patient Bill of Rights and Responsibilities. So this is Michigan Medicine's Patient Bill of Rights and Responsibilities. And certainly patients have rights. They deserve rights. They are some of the most vulnerable patients in the healthcare system, and many of them feel like they can't even speak up because of their positional power with the healthcare team. But what I want you to take away is that, yes, there are a lot of patient rights, but there's not very much written for patient responsibilities. So our study was really trying to understand what exactly are we telling our patients. So we conducted a cross-sectional evaluation of patient Bill of Rights and Responsibilities in 50 randomly selected hospitals that were affiliated with the AAMC. So these are all training hospitals. And we had two specific questions that we were trying to get at. The first was, is there a specific statement about the patient's responsibility to refrain from harassment and sexual harassment of healthcare providers? And simultaneously, is there in the policy that the patients themselves have the right to receive care free of harassment and discrimination? The second part was actually looking at the tone of the language and how this was communicated to the patients and their families. And so what we found within the 50 hospitals that we studied, all 50 of them had a patient bill of rights that was publicly available. When you looked for a patient bill of responsibilities, slightly more than 20% of them did not even have a patient's responsibility. There's nowhere that you could find it in a publicly available form. When you looked at the language of what was actually entailed in the patient bill of rights and responsibilities, the first bars up here are patient bill of rights. This lighter bar is that, yes, overwhelmingly, patient bill of rights had very specific language in regards to harassment and discrimination. And I'll give you examples on the next slide. But when you look at patient bill of responsibilities, overwhelmingly, it is suggestive language, if not missing. And very, very rarely do we specifically call out that the patients and their families will not harass their healthcare team. And what I mean by that is here. So oftentimes when we looked at the patient bill of rights, you saw phrases like, we will protect you from all forms of abuse, neglect, or harassment, or you have the right to be free from all forms of abuse or harassment. absolutely agree that should definitely be there. But when we look at the patient bill of responsibilities, what we often found was, take the second one, you have the responsibility to respect the dignity and the right to privacy of other patients and your healthcare team, or you have the responsibility to be considerate and cooperative. While I think the message is conveyed, it's not conveyed as clearly and concisely as it is on the patient bill of rights. And when we talk about feeling and changing culture, I think the words should all be the same of what we expect, what patients expect from us, and what we should expect from our patients. And so what this all shows is that we don't do a good job of providing our trainees with policies, protocols of what to do, but we also don't have very clear expectations that are clearly communicated to patients and their families. Now, some will argue, well, the patients never read them, so what difference does it make? And part of it is, I think it's in part, it shows that you care for your trainees and your healthcare staff. Not all policies, while they should be implemented, are necessarily written for those that it'll impact. It's also to show support for those that are dealing with the patients, that the institution as a whole will support them and expect them to be treated a certain way. So certainly more work to be done. And really, when you think about it, it left me, this work has been done over the last 3 years, with really trying to figure out, well, what do we do then? And as I reflected on my experience with my patient in clinic, I realized perhaps an algorithm would be a simple first step. So this was an algorithm that I published in Lancet in 2018. And the center focus of the algorithm was on patient safety, on physician safety. And really making it okay to say, I don't feel safe taking care of this patient because of how they're treating me. And therefore, perhaps there's someone else that I can find or other ways of managing this patient. And it was a simple first step. In no ways is it a solution, but at least begins to bring about the conversations of what we can do for our trainees. As this work came out, though, one of the most common questions that I got and received, well, what language do you use? Like, how do you tell a patient to stop? And how do you navigate that conversation? Of which I didn't have the answer. And to this day, I still stumble. This is something that's a continuous work in progress. I was really, really lucky. Dr. Shankar and colleagues published this in the Journal of Graduate Medical Education in 2019. It is a short article. It's an article that I give out constantly every time I go on service because it gives you language and it sets it up in three phases. The before, when you first start service, of the conversations you have with your trainees, the during, when the encounter occurs, and then the debrief after the situation. And so it sets the stage of what you do. I give this article out and I tell my team, expect that we'll talk about this in the coming days of like how we're going to deal with these comments when they do occur, because they almost always occur when I'm on service. It gives language for how to correct the behavior of the patient and or their family, and it gives you multiple different ways of doing it depending on your communication style. And then it gives you language for debriefing. And I think it's super important to debrief. Just like a code, it rattles people in different ways that one can't anticipate. We all come from different walks of life. We all have had different experiences. Each time this happens to me, I get a little rattled. I get a little rattled less each time, but it still rattles me. And going back and talking to the trainees, I think is worthwhile in ensuring that their well-being is there, because it'll be shocking for all of them as they continue to go through this. So I want to end with like, what are we doing here at Michigan and Michigan Medicine? And so I've been really, really fortunate in that I've worked with some amazing colleagues. We had a chief medical resident that worked at the VA, Luke Fraley, who's now a Hem/Onc fellow here at Michigan Medicine, and built a discrimination curriculum for internal medicine residents who, when they rotate through the VA and the Ann Arbor VA, excuse me. And it's come in a couple different flavors. The first, we started off with workshops where we had workshops on sexual harassment and patient perpetrated harassment and how do you use language and what language do you use? But as many endeavors, the same people would always show up. And that's not always the people that you're trying to reach. So we did have workshops for the internal medicine residents that has blossomed. It now actually occurs also within the pediatric residency and the med peds residency, and has been circulating into the hospitalist group as well. This next thing we did was actually build laminated cards. On one side of the laminated card are the actual phrases that one can consider using when these encounters occur. And they offer different options depending on your communication style. On the other side of the laminated card is the algorithm to consider when you are in these situations and do you feel safe. But there's also the numbers to call for when these encounters occur. So you're not Google searching, like, who do I need to call? Who do I report this to? How do I debrief? It's all located in one card that every resident gets when they start residency here. And then the most recent thing that we started is standardized patient interactions. So I think many med students are really familiar with the standardized patient and the fishbowl presentation where you are in front of a group. We are doing this, we started in the spring with Zoom, where the residents are practicing having these conversations with standardized patients who say inflammatory comments. And they are in a safe space where they can practice responding, and they have the support of trained attendings, but also their colleagues to help them find the wording and how to address the behavior. Overall, it's been really, really well accepted, and participation surprisingly has been engaging. It's something that I'm hoping to continue over this next year and then hopefully expand down to the medical school, since those trainees are not spared. So the big takeaways from this talk: the National Academies of Science, Engineering, and Medicine provide a framework for how we think about sexual harassment. Sexual harassment is common, and the most vulnerable amongst us experience it at higher rates. Gender disparities exist in many aspects of academic medicine, and it's driven by systemic barriers, which can be addressed. And gender equity is really an ethical imperative. And lastly, the organizational response is going to be critical if we're going to begin to make changes, which are desperately needed. And so with that, I will end this talk. I can't thank you guys enough for having me here. It is Women in Medicine Month, so happy Women in Medicine Month to everyone here, and happy to take any questions at this time.
Thank you so much. That was fantastic. We had a couple questions in the chat. One from Dr. Taylor Kusar. It was during the section when you were talking about promotion and the promoter section. I don't know if you could touch on the impact of intersectionality and the numbers for BIPOC women, for women of color.
It's just worse. It's always lower, which is really, really unfortunate. Like, we have numbers certainly for like women in general, but if you are an underrepresented minority, BIPOC, and add any other flavor of being a minority in medicine or in society in general, your numbers are just significantly lower across all aspects of academic medicine, including promotion.
And then early in the talk, you had shown the numbers of gender discrimination being much worse in medicine than among things like engineering and STEM sciences, where women are also underrepresented. Have you come across or any like rationale for why that happens more in women in medicine than in other like science-based fields?
They think it's because of those four organizational components of why medicine is just so much worse. And I think it's probably true. Like, we hit all four categories, and not all the sciences necessarily hit all four categories, but we are really unique in medicine, where we are male dominated in almost all fields. We also have a preponderance of, like, you know, the dyad relationship. We are a hierarchy unto itself, because that is how that's how we run, right? It's the attending, then it's a fellow, then it's a resident, then it's a med student. We build that pyramid in, and our culture is such that this is what we've promoted and have unfortunately created as a result. The sciences, while some of them are male dominated, do not necessarily have all of the other combinations. So we have the perfect storm to therefore lead the way, unfortunately.
So great. There was also a question, and when you were talking about the study looking at differences in startup packages, which really mm-hmm. struck me as well as somebody who will be looking for a startup package in several years, Do you think there was any, the question was, is there anything underlying that that reflects the type of research being done? Meaning that like one type of research may be more resource intensive than another.
Yeah, so the one where they actually found the statistical significance was in the PhD only. Like there were differences in the clinical and the health services, but the actual biggest difference was in like the pure scientists, the basic scientists. So I think it does speak to they need more money. And that's my understanding, having spoken to my colleagues that do basic science because of all their experiments. And in that group where they absolutely need the most money is where you see the biggest disparity exist. Which is really unfortunate to see, because without that money, you have a hard time getting your science up and going, which is the foundation of everything moving forward, unfortunately.
And then a couple questions on things that we can do. And so Dr. Merrick was hoping you could summarize what you think women mentees can do about things like promotion problems like on an individual level, and then similarly, what can female mentors do to help promote their mentees?
Yeah, so I reflect back because you guys did a phenomenal job when you talked about this about a month ago. As a female mentee, I have come to appreciate the open discussions and the network of peers. So I was under the impression that one, yes, I had heard that you needed to negotiate for salaries, but certainly like at this day and age, I wouldn't need to negotiate for salaries, only to hear like the three prior mentees ahead of me go, absolutely, you negotiate for salary. Absolutely, you negotiate for salary. And so there is wisdom to be had in talking to those around you that are your peers to understand how they are going through the process. The other reality is I often have stopped to reflect when I feel uncomfortable. And this is horrible to say, but it's true. Like, what would my male colleague do? Would they feel uncomfortable too? Would they ask for that? And then sometimes they ask them, would you ask for that? And they're like, absolutely. And it's like, okay, let me go ahead and ask for that. So it's beginning to break down some of the barriers and the stereotypes of like, no, you should just be grateful that you have this position, when you look to your counters and they're like, absolutely not. You deserve that position. I think is one thing. It's being proactive, building a peer network, asking your mentor the questions to get guidance when those stages come up, and don't just assume that you just say yes. From a female mentor perspective, I have come to really appreciate my female mentors. So I have Jack as my primary mentor, but I have a group of female mentors who have helped to guide me by showing me and sharing with me the hardships that they've had. So you can begin to identify where are you going to hit hiccups in your pathway, and what strategies have they used in the past, and what strategies can you implore then? I have communication with them when they occur. Like I have set up meetings with them briefly of like, do you have 15 minutes to chat? Like, this is where I'm at. What do you think? And that has proved invaluable as I've moved forward. And I do think there's change coming our way. I can't share the results just yet, but we have another study that I'm currently writing that looks at the letters of recommendation and how that may be changing for applicants.
We have a bunch of questions, but we probably only have time for one or two more. Going along that, you know, helping women in promotion, there was a question about, do you know, are there tools or recommended approaches that organizations themselves could take? So instead of just putting that onus on the mentee or the mentor, is there something that the institution can do to try to help women, especially early in promotion?
So I think there's early ensuring that there is actual networks for early career faculty, break that dyad so that there is an automatic network that's built. I believe here at Michigan Medicine, they're at year three on my K, I meet with the promotion committee to actually begin to identify like, where am I falling off and what do I need to hit to actually get to the next promotion milestone besides just getting a big grant, which I hear is like the mandatory thing. But having the institution also evaluate how are they promoting and what metrics are they using and making those completely transparent. So I know I need to reach X, Y, and Z in order to be promoted. I understand that that's not necessarily true at all institutions, and that oftentimes it's not clear what one needs to do exactly for promotion.
And if we have time for one more, are there differences in salary among men? Are there differences in salary between men and women reduced when leadership is female? Do you know if there are any data on that?
You know, that's a really good question. I don't know if there's any data on that. Not that I've seen. if women leadership will actually change that. It'd be a curious study to see if that has occurred as more women become leaders and seeing if those discrepancies begin to disappear. Fingers crossed that they do.
Yeah. Well, we've hit the 1 o'clock hours. I apologize if we missed any questions. They are in the chat, so Dr. Viglianti can see them. But thank you very much for coming and for speaking. This was a really informative and enlightening talk and a really wonderful topic. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much for having me. Happy Women in Medicine Month, everyone.